I'll be happy to answer. Good morning, friends, and welcome to today's webinar on price and cost analysis. As I said earlier, this topic ranks as one of the top critical procurement skills, and it's picked up in the last 2 years. As you're well aware, if you look around any companies, 50% of the revenue is used for procurement. Any company you go around, some place could be 70%, some place could be even 80%, some could be 50, but certainly 50 is a benchmark I'm taking around. If you talk of the sales, 50% of that goes into procurement, procurement of goods, procurement of services, procurement of MROs, CapEx, OPEX, whatever you want to call it. Hence, managing and reducing the cost remains the main focus to justify whether the price is reasonable or not. So that part certainly is very important. And I used this mantra myself when I was the chairperson of the UN. And we were having around 200 country offices. Any proposal comes to me running in millions and millions of time. My first question was, justify, is a price reasonable and fair? Reasonable is one thing. I have competitions. And second, is it fair? That's important also part of that. And if they're able to justify me, then I'll clear it. Otherwise, no. If somebody says, no, I got 5 offers, that is not the justification. That is one, but then we'll talk much more what makes reasonable. Now, what I plan to cover up in this webinar will be to basically to learn what, why, and how price and cost. I'm calling this as a learning journey. In future, possibly all our webinars will be part of the learning journey. And the focus in this learning journey is improved performance. So that's the key things around I will call around. Now, what we plan to cover is first to understand the difference between price and cost. This is where I find many times people have confusion. What is price? What is cost? Whether price drives the cost or cost drives the price. I'll touch on those parts also. Some places cost drives the price and some places price drives the cost around. What and why of price and cost? Why should I do it? Need, when to conduct, criteria for selecting the analysis type, methods of this and price analysis and cost analysis. There's a word called target cost and a should cost. Target cost means cost is fixed. So the target cost means my cost should not be more than that. Otherwise, I can't sell it. But there are competitors. And then should cost is based on my existing costing and cost element. Cost reduction and cost avoidance. The two key elements, I want each one to know what is cost reduction and what is cost avoidance. And lastly, but not the least, is TCO, TCO, TCO. So when we compare the offer, we are not comparing just on the price. We are comparing on total cost of ownership. Well, friend, with this, let me start with a quote around. Let's say if I'm saving a dollar gain in revenue, it's a very good thing. But remember the small portion, the end, reaches the earning. If I'm doing an increase of sale of, let's say, $100 million, but the profit margin which comes out of the 100 will be maybe 1/6 or 1/10 of it, maybe 10 million. But same 10 million, if you save in procurement, it straight goes to the bottom line. So your 10 million saving is equal to, let's say, $100 million increase in revenue. So that shows the importance of this around. So, I mean, everybody need to have understanding of managing the cost ensures a long value creation. And this gives you the same example, which I was talking around. This study was done again as a part of the survey global basis. They found 20% of the companies in the world are able to save 0 to 5% through procurement. And 40% are able to save 5 to 10% of the total spend. And 17% companies are able to save 10 to 15%. But then there are 3% who are able to save more than 50%. Somebody says, no, it's not possible. And here I always give them my own examples around dating back to 1972. We used to buy 1 million handles for the refrigerators made of brass and chrome plating. We changed the material to ABS, chrome plated. And the price came from 35 rupees to 17 rupees. Can imagine around saving was 50%. So saving can be brought from many tools, many ways around, through value analysis, through value engineering, through cost engineering, through cost modeling. There are many ways to do it. So this is the way survey was done, and this shows the picture how procurement can play a key role. Now this gives you again importance of cost saving versus sales revenue. So in the picture in the center, I have got a sales of $706 million. I increase my sale by 54 million on the left side, and then I get after tax profit of 75. On the right side, if you look around, I don't increase sales. I only put efforts on cutting the cost of MRO only. So I cut down the cost by 8 million versus 54 on the sales side. So 5% reduction, and my profit after the tax is exactly the same. So you can imagine around the importance of procurement and supply chain, which in the past was, I think, not understood around, but people thought procurement is a support function. But now procurement and supply chain has become a prominent function. So let me get back to the subject on cost and value management. We'll talk of cost modeling also a little later. Now, this has been the primary tenet of procurement professionals. Price reduction. I'm all the time calling procurement not the supply chain, because procurement still, if I look at the supply chain, procurement is the key component, the key pillar in the whole supply chain in terms of costing. So the saving has to come primarily from the procurement. So price reduction, reducing the total cost of ownership are the two key objectives. So with this, if you want to achieve a success, I think you have to put a lot of efforts on this around. Now, the purpose of price and cost, why we do it? Now, price is, when we talk of quoted by the supplier, the best estimates and subject to analysis and negotiation. So somebody has given us, they are the best estimates and are subject to what we do the negotiation. But the goal of price is to achieve best price. Whether I do cost analysis or price analysis, in both cases, I want to get the best price and a reasonable price, a fair price. So we are all the time analyzing the price for this reasonableness. Sometimes what we say around, guys, I've got a lot of competition. I've got 10 suppliers, 12 suppliers. I got 7 offers around, and they're all geographically spread over. They're not from one place. They could form a click around. So I can say, guys, okay, this price is the best one and gives me the same specs, same feature, same quality. So that helps me to justify reasonable. Or sometimes I look at the past data. From the past data, I've spent so much, now I'm saving it. Or even if it has gone up, it is in line with the inflation, I will say it's a reasonable. Now, very basic formula is price is equal to cost plus profit. I'm a supplier. There's a cost for me, and I'm supplying to your company. There's a cost for me, on top of it, I'm doing my margin. The question is, how big is the margin? And how much is the real cost around? Maybe my process is so inefficient that my cost goes up. That's why people are talking of clean slate nowadays concepts around. So my cost might have gone up because I'm inefficient. And my inefficiency, I'm passing on to my customer. So cost plus profit. And that's where the target cost comes in. We don't go with what costs you, what market can absorb. So we work back. So here is price is equal to very basic fundas, price is equal to cost plus profit. Well, how much should be profit? 5%, 10%, 15%? That we have to see around. What is reasonable? So we got three components: what you pay, what you expend. So cost is what you are spending around. What you're expending around your resources, and value means what you get. And that's what I've tried to clarify. Price is the amount to be paid. I want to get something from any suppliers, I pay them. I'm an automobile company, I buy tires, I'm buying this. So I pay to some X company, that's the price I'm paying for it. And that becomes my cost when I make end product. So cost is basically aggregate monetary values. So input used in the production. So I get something, the tires from someone, then somebody has to install it, somebody has to fix it. There's an additional cost. So the price component become my cost. On top of it, I put my resources, and that become my cost later. And then I put on top of it my margin. So value of the product is utility part. So value goes more than the cost part. That means there are two companies competing around. And this is happening very often, electronic items, even vehicles, where there's a big competition. The price may be same, but then some has got additional features. And those additional features, either they justify the price, or if they're not justifying, then there to be something special about it in terms of look, feel, quality, whatever you may call it out, it justifies the price. So price and cost is quoted by the supplier, the best estimates. We've discussed already on this. So price analysis is the key component which we talk of price analysis, price history. If somebody sends offer to me, say, Krishan, you have to approve this, has to show me the last, how much we were spending on. Then compounding, comparing price to internal projection. We might have projected in house because we're also selling something. It's a chain. I buy something, I convert into final product, I sell it. So my internal projection says, guys, okay, this is what we're going to sell and this is the price. And I work backward. Can this price be absorbed? Comparing competitive bids, using existing catalogs around. And there are some items where government fixed the price. So those items, particularly along with the oil and this, so there are areas around where government also fixes the price. Cost analysis. So when we are doing the cost, how much it costs me? How many people are going to work on? One, two, three, what are the rate of each one? Per hour rate. Hours of work by the person. Resource cost. Projected indirect cost. Evaluation of the cost. And this, the very first point, the person I use very often with many companies around, say, guys, can you tell me what are the cost of your procurement per purchase order? I'm not able to get answered. Then they come out some justification, said this may be around 6,000, 7,000 rupees, while in abroad it may be $150 a purchase order. The question comes starting from the requisition, how many people are required till the POs are made? Everybody is getting a salary. Everybody is putting a time on it. So if you take out the cost of it, what one PO costs you? So personal requirements, hours of work around, resource cost, any projected indirect cost, we're going to a big warehouse, transportation, taxes, fees, they're all going into my cost. Now, when we say price versus this, so price is very clear, I think it's explained earlier. The cost is a detailed cost element. The broad cost elements are within the direct and indirect, direct labor, direct materials, and within the indirect also, I've got indirect materials, indirect labor. On top of it, I've got overheads. So those are my cost elements. And on top of it, I have a G&A, my administration costs around. So there are many other things. So this is the way, in a very simple way, if I share on the price to summarize, competition, I get RFQ, I do RFP depending on the goods or services. So those competition give me offers. Then I've got historical price. So if any proposal used to come to me, I'll tell them, this is my table. I want the price, how many offers you got, what price they are, and then give me historical price, and then give me the parametric also. If you have some formulas now, we have never bought this. Let's say I was buying in the past only 200 megawatts. So generators around, now I want 400 something. So what are the parametric, what are the formulas, what should be the price these give me? Then I got the price list, sometimes standard items. We do the, again, market research also. We have the forecasting group also around. So we do the forecasting, we do the RFI, we try to get some data around. I remember a project when we used to have around $75 million, we were trying to lay down the copper cables over the transmission cables in Iraq program. So we have to do is get RFI, get the offers around, get information, do some market research. What should be the cost? other price for the wheelers around. So that's hobby. If I start comparing the price and cost analysis, price analysis is the simplest. They're just comparing offers, past history, that's all. Cost analysis is a very time consuming, very detailed. And competition has to be adequate in price. So I will go with the price analysis. That's sufficient enough if I were adequate. Adequate could be what, 4, 5, 6, whatever offers you have now, but not two. Two again, they may be from the same family, two suppliers, two companies, but maybe belonging to one company, family. Inadequate. So cost analysis is only when I've got no choice. I'm buying smart chips, I'm buying electronic items. There are not many choices available with us. And that's a place, now the manager has a difficulty to approve it because you only one offer, it's a monopoly offer. So they will say, guys, can you do the cost analysis? Now here again, question comes, some will give you the cost detail, some suppliers may not give it to you. The method is always in the price comparisons, cost breakdowns. So in what situation we could get for cost breakdown, civil works across the board, everybody gets a cost breakdown. If you're making a civil work, you say, guy, costing of this, they'll give it to you because you have a bill of material. The problems come sometimes very complex machineries. Even in the turnkey projects also, they give you the cost breakdown. So in some situations, you are able to get it, some not, but then still you have to do some justification to prove that the price which you're paying is reasonable or not. So price and its process, examining, evaluating the proposed price without evaluating separate cost. I'm not getting into the cost element. So then the next one is the cost analysis. And last is the cost realistic? The guy has given you beautiful figures around, but is there a scope for minimizing? And the guy has escalated the price. So if you know the cost of the labors, what should be in X country or Y country, geographically the rates are different. And you also know what is the price of each material around, then possibly you can find the realism part of it. Now let's take a simple example to identify the realistic price, material cost, 20,000. Materials overheads, 2,000, 10% around. Direct engineering labors, 1,000 hours, rate of $80 per hour. Engineering overheads, other direct costs, then general and administration costs, like renting, ACs, whatever you're talking around, 3% of the total cost. So we come with a profit margin of 15%. So that gives you a very broad, mostly in a Western country, the cost would be 251,000. But in addition to costing, sometimes we are driven by other factors. When we make a decision, we know very well this price is high. So that information was also compiled by our headquarters. 27% time, we are also driven by promotion. Somebody is promoting a lot, and we are biased with X product. Some product features are so good. So 23%, even if the price is on the higher side, you go for it, the brand. Sometimes you pay 5-10% extra for the brand. Online reviews are so good. If you look at the reviews, if you're buying a standard item, the reviews are poor, other one is going a good reviews. Even if the price is 5-10% more, you may justify. So these parameters also are affecting us, particularly when we're doing our own shopping or something. But same thing in the company law also, I think, to some extent. Now the question comes the cost of production. I have got two companies from where I'm buying. One has capacity of 1 million pieces. Other one has got capacity of 2 million pieces. So the one who has got 2 million pieces, if you're making, so here come the fixed cost and the variable cost. So in one company, obviously the break-even level may be lower. Other case, the break-even level may be higher. So the cost structure will depend on that parameter. So we need to look at that parameter. So fix the fix. You set up a plant. You have to pay for the rent. You have to pay for the electricity. You have to pay for the bare minimum staff to keep the building running. So those are your fixed costs. Then when you start doing the production, more you produce, more material is required. So that's my variable cost. Today I'm making 1,000 pieces. My variable cost is this. But when I make 2,000 pieces, my variable cost. So variable cost goes very straight line. The total cost is a combination of my variable cost versus fixed. Fixed cost is a fixed cost. I have a fixed building. Variable means I'm hiring more people. I'm getting more material. And this is going around. So now comes here, I have my sales revenue. Now sales revenue, and then I've got the previous slides around variable cost plus fixed cost, the place where they merge, that's a break. So any sale more than that, break even. So per piece cost will be low. Per piece cost will be lower. Also, if I go with the more the numbers, my fixed cost is spread over the big numbers. So even in the variables, also components. So you can see around this is the break even. So that's what we look at. So if I've got two companies, one case has got a break even of 10,000 pieces. Other one has a break even of 5,000. And if I'm buying less than 5,000, maybe that's more justified. But normally when the companies have bigger capacities, their volumes are bigger, they are able to justify buying the raw material at a cheaper price. And their production batches are bigger, so their cost may be lower. Now, the broadly, if I say around the cost, so when we say contract price, is the cost plus profit, as we said. So cost is a combination of direct and indirect. So I've got my direct cost. Then I've got other direct costs like travel and vendor toolings. Tooling is a big cost around. Direct materials also. Indirect costs is G&A and then facility components around all capex and this and the burden overhead source. And inventory ILS is also there around. Total cost is sum of direct and indirect cost. So the direct cost is the one which goes directly to the end product. So which is the direct material, direct labors. If I'm making two products, one side I'm making mining equipment, other side I'm making air conditioning equipment. So one which goes directly to X product is a direct cost. Other one goes indirect cost. But there could be some cost which is going on both sides. But normally they're of low values and I'm not able to justify it belongs to X or Y, I'll share it between the two. So there's a direct cost and the indirect cost. So indirect costs are not easily identifiable in the final cost object. Suppose you're having, even in the IT business around, you're having two software development going on. My team is working on one software side. Other team is working on another software development, but there may be some people for supporting both. So they will go into my indirect cost. So anything which I can't pinpoint is going for X project or Y project, X product or Y product, I'll put them as indirect cost. So alternative direct cost treatments around. So this is the way I think the same chart which I showed is direct cost, direct material cost, indirect cost. And last is escalation time. Now, when we talk of steps for labor cost estimations, so it needs a special attention on direct labor hours skills. Now, this concept used to be very common. I mean, I started my career in '72 in Tata Zaram. We used to have industrial engineers. Every operation in the factory, there used to be time and motion study around. We used to have timing for each one. So we used to have a standard time for each and every activity. But now more and more outsourcing, because in the good old days, outsourcing was less. Most activities were done within the parent company. very less going to the small and medium. But now 60 to 70% is being outsourced around. So this activity has shrunk in my mind. But still, at the other end, the people who are providing you OEM to the parent company, they must be doing around the costing. So in good old days, we used to have two types of people. One we used to call as a cost engineer, you could call. And then we used to have people in the finance who have the direct exact cost of, who are cost accountants. They have the cost rates around for each one. Now those activities are still going on. But the other side, the cost engineering is picking up now because now people feel there's a time has come that we should start looking at the engineering of the cost rates. Can we cut the cost? Can we improve the efficiencies around? Can I make different way? Can I change my setup time? So that way I'm able to compete better. Instead of accepting, oh, this is my cost. Today I'm doing a batch of 20 pieces. Then I think, can I make it from 20 to 25? Possibly I can cut my cost by another 4%. When I cut by 4%, my margin increases. Even if margin doesn't increase, I'm competitive around. So that type of activity is started. So in the production side, this word is picking up. So when we do the cost estimations, it could be through the round tables. Let's say we have experts around. I'm doing costing, forging, they're an expert, they will tell you just with formulas around, okay, this is the cost of this. Comparisons, parametrics. So basically use the formulas for cost estimation. As I said to you, if I'm buying a generator of 200, then if I go to 400 megawatts or 400 kilowatts, then I know very well what should be the formulas, what ratio I have to apply. So those are basically, I won't call gut feeling, but based on some market analysis, they know very well this should be the ratio. A detailed, thorough reviews made, which is comprising of the estimations. So round tables, strength is, can we use the limited data? That means people are sitting around the tables. They are experts. They have the data. But the lack of data increases variability between the estimators. If you ask the estimators who call themselves experts, one might have come from one background, one might have come from another company backgrounds. So then you may find a lot of subjectivities around. So to get objective cost is becoming difficult. So the second is a comparison. I've got the estimates. And the detail is you go into more accurate estimates. Let's look at the cost elements again. So cost element is material. So I'm doing again scrap, discount, miscellaneous. Then I've got material handling costs around 2%. So $100 was there, so scrap is 1%. Material handling cost is 2%. Direct labor is so much. Labor category, X category, level one, level two. Skill level, unskilled level. Total cost around, fringe benefits around, overheads. How much is the travel involved around, total other direct cost around, G&A expense, and then I find it will. Now, this used to be, you can call as a cost management tools. But now the concept is coming of cost modeling. In a cost modeling, I started looking around. What is the material cost 100? Can I change the material? Why? Why this range? The rate has gone up. Can I think of an alternative material? Can we think of a chain here? Material handling. Can we automate the material handling? From 2%, can I go to 1%? So I started looking at the cost drivers around. So the focus is going away from the very passive approach, going into more active approach, and that's what we call the cost modeling. So from cost management, people are switching over to cost modeling. And cost modeling is more like a cost engineering. Now, coming back to the definition of fair and reasonable. I mean, there's no specific definition. So what we do around is basically, okay, we see the previous prices around. We look at the cost detail if required around. If the competition is less, then we look at the cost. And then try to come up with a justification, yes, this is reasonable. Then we also look around what competitors are doing. If my competitors are selling at a much lower price, and mine is on the higher side, then there is not justification. So bottom line, so price reasonableness, I can do with price analysis, and that also only if I have got a reasonable number of competition. Problem comes on the other side, when there's no competition, so monopoly item. So before the start of the session, I know many were raising about the question on CapEx and other. So those situations remains in some areas, but we can justify in other approach around. Now coming back to two things now, standard cost. Standard cost was basically based on the cost elements. Cost elements mean if I'm producing X or Y item, there's a direct cost. Let's say I'm manufacturing laptop. I know very well the body is made either of aluminium or of plastic or whatever material now, and I know the material rate amount. How much is the quantity of this? The rest is the molding cost. So I know the material part. Then come the next one, the labor part. Make the outer body, to make the mother chips or even the screen, if we know what is the cost of each one. So each element, whether it's a human elements, material element, process element, handling elements, each one has a cost element. So those cost elements, if you can work it out, so that becomes, so whenever a new product is made, so first you think, okay, how much is going to be the standard cost element? And I've got the cost detail with my cost or cost accountant, cost engineers, and they can give me, and then they can work. But then the next come, most popular is the target cost. The target cost is the difference in the target prices and the reasonable cost. The target is fixed, so you work backward. So here I can give you my own personal example on this. So I was working in Malaysia on a project, one of the renowned IT companies, I mean, this laptop manufacturing company, they were trying to say that we want to come into the hybrid model. They're well known, but they were not in the hybrid model. They wanted to come with the hybrid. And the competition was already there. So in short, the competitor price was $1,100. So naturally, we work backward. You can't live in your own world. So there are other people, they are selling at $1,100. If I want to get into that, and salespeople told us, then guys, if you want to get into this business, our price should not exceed $1,050. So the target price is fixed. So, I mean, we are not even still started manufacturing it. We are not still outsourced, nothing. 100% product was made through outsourcing. So we are being given the target as $1,050, out of which $200 gone for overheads. So left up with $850. And all the $850 were at the available to head of the procurement or supply chain. And he was told, the head of the procurement and supply chain, here is $850. And the number of pieces would be 2 million pieces. Work backward. And in that hybrid system, there are 120 components going to around 30 suppliers. So now you are the boss. Think of the future. This is the way trend is moving now, where companies are outsourcing and you're trying to compete. Somebody's already in the market and you have to work backward. Now this guy is given a target, guys. Okay, here is $850, 2 million pieces. And this has to be made. How you spread your costs, I leave it to you. But does not mean that quality has to be compromised, no chance. So no compromise on qualities. On the contrary, we want more features. We want better features than the competitors, and we're working backward. That's the beauty of the target cost. And this concept is used very often by the Japanese. When the Honda shifted to some of the activity to the US in the 80s, they did a lot on this around. So you can't work in isolation. So you think of, put yourself into the shoes. You're the boss. And then the top management says, guys, here's $850. Get it made. And then you have to spread the cost between the 120 elements, 34 suppliers. Because the interesting projects, I enjoy. Now, target cost process are establish the target costs. Do the market research. A lot of market research. So those 34 suppliers which they were buying, we have to really go into the detail of their manufacturing, how they do it. Can we do some industrial engineering concept to cut the cost around? Can we use value engineering to cut the cost around? Can we improve the process to cut the cost around? So product planning, concept development stages. So value engineering played a big role around, and continuous improvement. Does not mean if I've done a value engineering now, I've done for my lifetime, no chance. The market is changing. And the Japanese, when they say Kaizen around, it's a continuous improvement. So continuous improvement means we need a lot of team work around. We need quality circles, suggestions, improved morale, personal discipline, all those things are required. So design stage again. Now, again, many of you may be in the production environment, so they are, I'm sure, used to it. Those who are in the only procurement but not used to manufacturing culture, keep in mind this is what we need to do in suppliers. Another thing comes up is now the total cost of ownership. I know in the good old days we were talking of price. But now people are saying, guys, okay, I'm paying lower price upfront, but the maintenance cost is too high. I have to train my people, that cost is too high. Downtime is too high. I lose more resources, otherwise. Upfront, I might be showing saving, but on the ground level, I'm wasting more funds. That's the concept came of TCO. So we have a life cycle cost, we have a TCO concept around. So life cycle cost means something in the real capex, I look at that way. So if you have a capex, and you know very well the life could be 10 years for depreciation, so look over 10 years. But for other items, I look at the total cost of ownership and which elements to involve around. So the price which you're talking about is the tip of the iceberg. But the behind this, the training cost, maintenance cost, support cost, that also has to be seen. So this is where it shows around the TCO, the purchasing cost is a tip of the iceberg. Actual cost could be higher. Suppose my company is a price who's giving me low price. The lead time is 1 month. Other one is giving me higher price, but lead time is 1 week. So 1 week versus 1 month or 4 weeks. So 1 week versus 4 weeks, I have to keep a stock of 4 weeks. In other case, I can keep a stock of 1 week or 1.5 weeks. So I save my money there. My money is not blocked there. And in case tomorrow the market goes down, I don't keep too much inventory for nothing. So those costs are also to be looked into. So whenever we're thinking of inventory cost, warranty cost, warehousing cost, if I have to keep for 4 weeks, my warehousing cost goes up. Other one I do for 1 week, my warehousing cost goes down. So it's a combination of all the parameters. That's what we call the TCO. Another issue which is becoming very popular around, and we are doing a workshop next month on sustainable procurement. So when we talk about sustainable, one product is made by polluting the whole world. Other one, less pollution, less carbon footprints. Somebody has to pay the price for it. So those components, if you start adding around, it becomes a TCO cost. Very simple example, which in our home front, we do it. You want to buy a car. The price, sticker price is $22,000. Non-hybrids and hybrid mode. Then we have the taxes and the fees. for insurance premiums, fuel consumption. One consumes less fuel, one consumes more. Maintenance costs, repair costs, interest. After adding all of them, the one which was again on this side, 22,000, the other one was 23,000, it lands up at 35. And the non-hybrid becomes 40,000. So that's what shows us the power of TCS now. Now, costs are price data not required. Now, if you feel cost data, if you want to really get into it, time consuming. I can understand that. So I will not encourage people to go into the cost data if I feel I've got enough competition. So that's the way we say either the contracting office is done, the prices are based on inadequate competition, we avoid. I will not get into the cost data. Our country office determines the prices are set by law and regulation, so not anyway. The government has fixed the prices now. And if it's a commercial act, then I have got many catalogs now on e-commerce items. I can check the compare the prices. Or the boss has said, guys, let's not waste time, go ahead, because it's urgently required. So on this situation, you may not go for the cost meters around. Otherwise, certainly when the projects are much bigger around, I remember the project that we used to have $30 million, $40 million, $70 million contract. Costing was the must. So now coming back to the issue on, again, CapEx and this, like we were also doing a CapEx, but that CapEx was a different way, I would call it. Transmission towers, cables, we could do the costing easily. And we asked the supplier, guys, can you tell me how much is the tons of material you're using in the towers around? What is your labor cost? What is your this cost? Complete cost they were given to us. And we could compare with the market. Second, on the cable side also, we could check around 70% of the cost is copper. And copper rate was linked with London Metal Exchange. So we could do the costing on that also. So in those situations, yes. But if I'm buying something sophisticated, computerized, numerically controlled machine, and there's only one supplier, Farouk, in those situations, I know it becomes difficult, but then you have to justify the cost, whether you will get the return on investment or not. Today, I'm doing with the mechanical machinery. Now I'm going with a highly sophisticated machinery, and the cost is 50% more. Maybe the rejection also goes down. So I have to justify based on income. If I'm having a competition, then not a big issue. But if there's no competition, there's a unique company which makes it specialized for us, that's a different company. Now, indicators of deficiencies. What are the deficient things or change? First thing is historical data, not available. Failure to analyze material cost. So most of the materials I can link with London Metal Exchange, you can do that part. So if you are able to do that, great. Sometime price may be going down, sometime up. So when we were doing a project of 3 years, so we said, guys, okay. So whenever we make payment, we look at the price of the copper in London Metal Exchange, and this was the initial price. Based on that, we make adjustment. No analytical support. Excessive relying on judgment. I think those days are going away. People from my generation, I know they used to go with gut feeling. Today, nobody wants to listen in the gut feeling. Yes, they will listen to you, but they will not be able to sign and approve it. They want, everybody wants some justification. Recurring defective pricing, failure to integrate relevant parts from the management information system, and we don't have any policies and procedures. This one I find is missing around some companies where it is relevant enough. So particularly those who are in manufacturing, those who are outsourcing a lot. So that place, I think the cost estimation is required justification, and particularly when we don't have competition. So in some companies, what we started around, we said, write to them that we need for audit purpose, can you please give us some cost detail? So then companies are willing to give it to us. Because some companies are scared to give you because they feel that you may share up that information to some other supplier. So that's why, but if you tell them that your information will remain secret, and we have a cooperation with the supplier, we work as a collaborative supplier, then in those situations, they may give it to you. But if you're treating them as outsider, then possibly they may not give it to you. Now there are two components. One is called cost reduction, one is called cost. I'm sure most of you, you have to show that your procurement is not a cost center. Some companies are trying to switch over that we are not a cost center, we are a profit center. I've got a team of 25 people or 30 people, cost of them in their salary, their space, whatever you talk around, is let's say $2 million. But if I'm able to save more than $2 million, I'm a profit center. I'm not a cost center. The profile of procurement changes. So cost reduction in many companies, correct me, if you are showing that I've saved so much, it has to be justified by the finance. Your saying is one thing, but it has to be justified that you are able to cut down the cost compared to the previous years through negotiation, changing some material, whatever you want to say. So that's what we're looking at, the cost reduction. Because cost reduction means which is going to be reflected this year in my, say, year 23-24 or 22-23 financial year. But cost avoidance means I'm doing some negotiation, I'm doing some valuable leases, impact may come later. It's not there now. It's not a hard dollar. It's a soft dollar. It may happen or may not happen. Tomorrow we may change the design. So avoidance means you are working it hard for the future, and saving means which is straightway finance can justify that you have saved compared to the previous years based on your skills. Now this is the one I want to touch a little bit on the cost part. So far we were talking on the cost managing part. Now we talk about cost monitoring. If you look at two scenarios, commitment to committative price. I'm committed to committing price on the x-axis. Then the y-axis is I'm more interested in relationship. So if I go with the relationship on the y, x is the price. I want to say more. So divide them into four quadrants. So the low ones, low commitment to relationship, low commitment to competition. Because I've got multiple choices. I'm buying office supplies. I'm buying some items which are available on X or Y catalogs around. I can buy through e-commerce. There are multiple choices. So those items which are coming under the low competitive price, and then the risks are very low, I could build up my own catalog for my company and they say, guys, okay, here are the possible suppliers. So basically we are price takers. Then the other one is the Darwinian theory, which we used to talk, competition. I want competition. I've got multiple choices. My risk is also very low. There are many suppliers who can deliver me. And if risk is low, I don't care for relationship. And I've got a significant purchasing clout. You are the one who are buying it. You have a clout. People will listen. You are the biggest buyer. You come from a very reputed company. They want to work with you. So they want to work with you because of your brand. Your business is too big. And working with you adds their performance also. So Darwinian revival, I mean, here is the one you do competition. So in the cost modeling, the first we have to model ourselves into four boxes, then come to the balance, which is here I want to be collaborate with them. I have got no choices, to be honest. I'm in a, let's say, IT business around, I need a chip, there's only one company. I have got no choice in the company until I set up a new plant to make that. So I had to go into the balance purchase. I have to work as a collaborative approach. And collaborating means we try to leverage supplier capability. While in the other one, I work on a partnership basis, on a trust base. So here I'm working on a corporation because relationship is equally important, but competition price is not so important. On the, this side, on the right side, on the revenue and the balance purchasing, I need competition. But here I'm having competition in the lower end. Upper quadrant, no. Then I go into collaboration. So in one case, I go into the collaboration. Other one, I go into the corporation. Here, I don't get into the anything. So basically, I can do through automated robotic process automation box. And this one, I could do with what you call as the reverse auction. I could do revenue and I could do reverse auction. It's quite a lot, very successful. So your approach changes around one place. I use reverse auction, which I could call even electronic negotiation. Balanced purchasing means I'm getting into collaborative approach. Here I'm getting into cooperative approach. Here I'm not doing anything. I'm just going with the e-commerce business. I've got an e-catalog around. So my cost modeling means I have to define my cost drivers. So when we were doing around this project, I was talking up. So we said, guys, okay, here's the motherboard, here's this, here's the body, how it is made, what is the cost of this, what is the material of this, can we think of a change around? So it is a cross-functional approach. Keep in mind, it's not only procurement. Procurement, design, everybody joins hands together, and then we do the whole cost drivers. How can we cut the cost? So what if analysis is one thing, and what is different thing? I hope all of you know where two things are. What if means I'm taking the word is stable. Nothing is changing. I know the cost elements and I'm only going with them. That is called what if. Other one is say, guys, what is? What if mean I'm questioning everything? So what is mean, sorry, what is the one I'm going with the standard cost element? What if means I'm switching over change part. So that's the way around. So in the good old days, it was all what is this? What is the cost element? We just do mathematically. Very straight line approach, very linear approach. Now people don't want to walk linear, they want to go in circle. So then become what if analysis. Another thing which is becoming popular in this subject is value analysis. So there's a word called value engineering. Other one is called value. Engineering means when I'm on the drawing board, I'm doing the design. But I'm a good designer, but I'm not conversant with how to manufacture. The cost may be too high. But value analysis means the design is ready, you know, design has gone to the head of the procurement people. And the procurement people, when they go to the supplier tells them, sir, can you make a change here? Then the cost could cut down. Then I go back to the design and change. That's called that. So value analysis is afterthought, and value engineering is very front end when the design is released. And sometimes value also is seen as how many functions I get. You and me buy a car, one gives you more features around. You say, guys, I don't mind paying extra 10,000. Oh, this feature is so good. So those extra features, divide by the cost, then you are getting value for money. So that's what we do. Now, the tools which are used to determine the price, one is called Producer Price Index. Another one is called CPI, which I'm sure you all know, Consumer Price Index. If inflation now, which is going around 7%, 8%, that also affects the cost. PPI is the one which, if I'm buying X item and Y item, I'll say this supplier's producer price 2 years back was this, 3 years back was this, and today how much is as per the catalog of the supplier? So I get the PPI. And then also I have some idea about the wholesale price index, what changes are required. So those trends are available in India. Many of the items are on. So that helps us to, but not certainly for the capex in this. So those items, I could say, is treated. But common items, common user items, yes. You're buying air conditioners, tables, furniture, you can easily find PPI, WPI, but CPI you can use for every place. Here comes the cost reduction to count. We got ABC category, all of us know very well. Or we could say Pareto analysis 80-20. I'm going to spend category A, spend category B, spend category C. You are the boss. You're spending around $2 billion a year. You've got A, B, C category. Now, 10% of the suppliers are coming under the A category, but they cover 80% of your spend. But 15% of the suppliers or even the parts could be B, but money-wise, only 15%. C-class items, money-wise, only 5%. But the time which we are spending around, now there are two types of people who are very tactical buyers, simple getter, they call it, in a very simple word, getter. Go and get. They spend 80-75% time on C item. So very little time on A item, where the potential of saving is much more. While in the case of strategic buyer, they'll spend time depending on how much saving I can get. So if I'm working and focusing on A item, I could be doing with a small efforts much more. So you can see that a 1% saving of 80% of your total spending is will be higher than even the 10% saving of zero. So if you are the boss, you have to look around where to put focus. So that's what it shows around the ABC analysis of cost saving. So yes, we want to be strategic buyers, but don't get into the small nitty-gritty getters and whole time is wasted on that. Another thing comes up is indirect spending analysis. Now, most of the indirect spending, I think, which we have around, they focus on high, they usually focus on high, most of the procurement team. Indirect expense, which you look around, will not be handled by the purchasing department. Sometimes they're handled by the people who are budget owner. I'm working in HR, I'm working in legal, I'm working in maintenance. I need something, I have my own budget. Either I go through you or I go myself. So some places I've seen around, the budget owner, they place the order. And they're not trained in the procurement profession. And some organizations we have seen that indirect is viewed with value is too small. They say instead of going through X process or Y process, and procurement process may cost $100, the process from end to end, we will do it ourselves. So those areas need to be reviewed around, particularly MROs. I've seen in many big companies, oil and gas companies around. They're going for MRO item with the same supplier, same compressor they're buying from them, which was bought 30 years back. Because it came in the turnkey plan. Now they want exactly same, they don't want to make any risk around. So naturally, when you go with the older model, it's just like having an ambassador car, and then you want engine which was 30 years back. Come on, guys, it's going to cost you enormous. So one has to change with the time. MROs also now the 3D printing has started coming around in some materials that could also cut the cost. And I have a few examples around where it could cut the cost. So we need to look around indirect spending, MRO, indirect spending, particularly if buying laptops, computers, furniture. That's a place where we need to have long-term agreement. MROs, one needs to have a different thoughts around. Closing thoughts, if I want to say around, the modern procurement operation supply relationships are raising the bar of operation excellence. So the old concept is going away. Procurement has become very prominent in the last 2 years. I would say hardly any person in procurement lost their job around in the last 2 years. This profession worldwide has picked up its charm, I would say around. So the only thing the term is changing around, this is what procurement people are calling it supply management. So it's becoming a strategic function. But to support lasting results from strict cost analysis, they need to develop the cost engineering function. So strict cost is, what if it's there? I mean, I've got the cost elements, which were designed by my accounting or industrial engineers people 5 years back, and I'm going with the same cost element. Machining cost so much, this so much, this so much. Now people are looking around, can I change the approach? So we need a cost engineering function. Cost analysis is a time consuming and new CFD. So lean I will advise is a very time consuming. So if you don't have a competition, then certainly this needs to be done. Otherwise, audit will question. Now people are getting into caution. Excellent, this is a lean being promoted by McKenzie's. They say, guys, somebody gives you the cost data, you get convinced. But the way they are making around may be very unproductive, very inefficient. So if you want that approach, a change approach on manufacturing, so that's what we call the clean sheet. Just like clean sheet, don't go with what old machine you bought. Many of you have a turnkey project designed 30 years back. And same 30 years back, if today you have to design, you will design different way. Your process will be much smarter than that. It's just the next generation of product. Well, friend, with this, I want to thank you all. I know this subject is evolving with the time. There's a lot to learn around. I know I've put some words around on cost modeling this, but there's a lot to learn around. So, well, friends, with this, the floor is open to you. If any questions you have around, before I thank you. So, guys, come on. Any questions, anything?